Hello, and welcome to the final instalment of the Ellen MacArthur Foundation's Summit 21, an online event spread over 3 days exploring one big idea, the circular economy. Our mission at the Foundation is to accelerate the transition to a circular economy and hopefully inspire you to play your part. I'm Joe.
And I'm Laura, and we are here to guide you through a series of conversations that explore shifting the system. It's easy to get theoretical and a bit fussy when talking about systems. So let's start with something practical.
This is a film about plastic pollution. Actually, it's about solutions. Upstream Innovation offers solutions to design out packaging waste. Ask yourself, do we need this or not? Sure, you can't always just eliminate the packaging. So rethink the product or rethink the packaging. Cucumbers need plastic to stay fresh, right? Wrong. You know what's really cool? Spray them with an edible spray instead. Reuse is another great solution to design out waste. You can reuse this bottle to make your own cleaning product, like that. And don't buy single-use bottles with bubbly water if you can add bubbles to your tap water. And should all these single-use bottles be different, or can they share one reusable design? Now, if eliminating the packaging doesn't work and reusing things doesn't work, then at least the materials should stay at work. So when we start to design a product or packaging, maybe we shouldn't do it from many materials, but from a single material and a single colour, or no colour. And that is just one example. So if you're looking for packaging solutions, read this guide. Get your copy, because this film will eliminate in 3, 2...
Plastics pollution is a symptom of a broken system. Too often products and their packaging are conceived in tunnel vision, with one use case in mind. Designing an object that fits the system means recognizing where it has come from, how it will be used, and where it's going.
And it's not just about product design. Business models, logistics, infrastructure, investment, laws and regulations, and many more factors that all combine make a system. So shifting a system often requires making changes in a lot of places, like in the structures, relationships, and mindsets, or the culture embedded in it.
So how do you change the plastics packaging system? And beyond that, how do you change other systems, like food, fashion, construction? And ultimately, how do you change the global economy? Brunswick Group's Lucy Parker put these questions to the Coca-Cola company's CEO, James Quincey, and Mariana Mazzucato, professor at University College London, and the author of the newly released Mission Economy, A Moonshot Guide to Changing Capitalism.
Our focus for this conversation is shifting the system. And I have two great guests who have a lot to say on the subject, born of all their work to do exactly that. Try and shift the system. James Quincey, who brings with him the perspective of private enterprise, and Mariana Mazzucato, who is such a leading voice on public value. So hello to you both, and great to have you here coming from the same subject from different perspectives. Let me start by saying one of the problems in shifting the system is the system is so huge. It's enormous. Not one of us can get our arms around it. And there are so many players and so many challenges, and they're all interconnected. So surely the first question has to be, how do you get started? Where do you actually get in on the question? And so, James, can I throw that to you first? Where do you get in on the system to shift it?
Great question. I think the system can be moved if we get a few things in place to start with. Firstly, the objective. do we actually all agree where we're trying to go? And that's it's seemingly obvious, but sometimes in the maelstrom of trying to make things happen, the objective gets moved and diluted. And, you know, in this case, we're talking about the circular economy on packaging materials, and we're saying we don't want waste, but it's more than just waste or eliminating waste. We want to actually reduce our carbon footprint. So, in simple terms, you could turn, we've got a plastic waste problem, let's have no plastic and move to a different material that actually could drive up our carbon footprint. So the key first step is, what's the objective? The objective in this case, no waste, lower carbon footprint. It's not don't use a material, it's the circular economy. And then the second two critical elements to getting the whole thing started, one is some degree of regulation. The shift in the system needs some regulation, whether it's regulation to approve use of recycled materials that come back from the circular economy or set up collection systems. And then it needs demand. And that's particularly, you know, when you ask what's the role of the Coke company, one thing we can do is send the demand signal. We're the buyer of the recycled material. And so the demand signal comes from companies like us saying, here's what we want to buy so that it meets our objectives of a circular economy. And that then can help reshape the supply chain behind us. So it needs clarity on the objective, some degree of regulation, and economic incentives, particularly from those that create demand.
And thinking within the company, that's a huge operational shift within an organization like yours. So inside the organization, what do you have to do to get it moving?
Within a company like Coke, it very simply needs to become part of the business objective or the business vision. You know, you could look over all business history, and whilst anything that people have done where there's the business runs here and I've got some ancillary or parallel objective that I have on the side, it ultimately fails to attract enough to attention and sustainability if it's not integrated into the business. So for me, the principal way of galvanizing the Coke company and the Coke system is to make it an inherent part of the business vision, which is actually, in a way, a force of driving the economics. Because if you can say the long-range vision of the circular economy is not just no waste and lower carbon footprint, but is actually lower cost than the alternative, then the system can galvanize itself around reorganizing and reorientating towards it. And we've already got countries where we've got, you know, all our packaging, or at least the plastic packaging, in 100% recycled. So it's doable. And from an operational point of view, if you can show everyone places where you've made it work sustainably and within the business imperatives, then it's much more powerful than it being ancillary.
And that's a perfect cue, Mariana, to ask you how you would actually move beyond what James has been talking about, which is plastics and waste. Where are the other kinds of systems that we ought to be looking for this kind of intervention in? Because it's incredibly impressive to hear about the plastics and waste story, and it's captured public imagination. It's a way people actually can relate to it. But there are many, many systems we're trying to drive towards circularity, aren't there? What are the other ones you think we should be focused on?
So, I mean, I really agree with what James was talking about in terms of vision and leadership. And I think the problem is that it can't just be isolated companies or even, you know, kind of one government here and there. It really has to go to the center of how we actually think about economic change and societal change. And in fact, one of the things I've been trying to do over the years is trying to help governments redesign their policies. So it's less about kind of pet projects, whether it's around plastic or any sort of particular area. It's really about saying, what does it mean to actually design policy to be goal-oriented, and less about kind of picking random sectors or even random types of technologies or types of firms, right? There's this obsession about small, medium enterprises. Instead of looking at a type of firm, type of technology, type of sector, what does it actually look like if you have goals that are ideally starting with the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals? There's 17 of them. Every country has signed up to them. There's 169 targets beneath them. But the problem is that if you just stop at the goals, they're quite broad, right? So, you know, SDG 13, you know, life underwater, clean oceans, what does it actually mean to turn that into a moonshot, right? Like a plastic-free ocean over a certain amount of time and get as many different sectors involved in the process. So whether that's, you know, the chemical sector, social innovation, biotech, design, AI, marine, and so on, they have to actually work together. And that's what got us to the moon. I've just written a book on called Mission Economy that, you know, getting to the moon was not just about aerospace. It was lots of innovation in nutrition, materials, electronics. The whole software industry in some ways was a spillover of that. But the other thing is that government back then was much more confident, I find, and capable in some ways than many public institutions are today. And they really focused on how to work with business, how to actually design what I call a symbiotic, mutualistic public-private partnership, and not what we see in some areas like health, where sometimes we have parasitic public-private partnerships. So what does it mean to actually design the contracts themselves to be outcomes-oriented? The state, I really do think, at least in democratic societies, has the duty to actually set the direction for change, but then leave very open the how. Right? You can't micromanage that process, but really setting a goal, you know, again, plastic free ocean, carbon neutral city, but also ones around inequality. And, you know, that kind of mindset of picking the willing, having a mission oriented, outcomes oriented approach to policy, crowding in as many bottom up solutions, that just requires a huge cultural shift as well within the public service. It means, you know, experimenting, risk taking, seeing yourself as a co-creator, co-shaper of markets of the future, not just a fixer of markets, because one of the big systems problems we have is that we keep waiting for the system to break down or to maybe break down before we really think about any sort of government policy. And that's actually within the economic theory itself, which unfortunately is very powerful in terms of how policymakers think, which is that policy is seen as just fixing market failures. So by definition, you will always be too little, too late.
So interestingly, what I'm hearing there is an echo of James's point, which is you need a picture in your mind's eye, a goal, a mission, as you call it, that you're designing towards. And that's how it actually works, which I think takes us very neatly, in a sense, to the second theme, which is you're saying everybody needs to be working together. There's a different nature of collaboration needed here. But how would you say that needs to actually happen in practice? Because one of the stresses and strains is that because everybody needs to collaborate with everybody, you can't find a focal point. So what's your experience of how different people play their parts in this collaboration in a constructive and practical way?
So, I mean, my view is that markets themselves are outcomes of how we design the governance structures within all the different value-creating organizations. So within the private sector, public sector, third sector. And one of the really interesting things right now is that there's a conversation within the business community about stakeholder value, you know, purposeful business. And my kind of real gut instinct is that that's never going to create real systems change unless it goes to the center of the system of how all the different actors actually work together. So a purposeful system, not just purposeful corporate governance, as important as that also is. And that means, for example, coming back to my point about design, it means, you know, you should never just have kind of handouts, you know, and there's lots of handouts, subsidies, guarantees for all sorts of different companies. It has to be conditional and not conditional like a stick. It shouldn't be a negative thing that you're kind of punishing someone if they don't do something. But you can imagine that, you know, even now with COVID-19, trillions of dollars, euros, pounds are being injected into the system. Unless that is actually, again, designed in a way that truly builds back better. And I'm not just thinking about COVID-19 build back better, but build back better towards more sustainable, inclusive growth.
And James, that seems to me to offer you a very interesting challenge, you collectively as leaders of business, because historically the relationship between governments and business, once it's come to regulation, has been somewhat adversarial. It's almost a sort of traditional standoff. And the very first words out of your mouth really included, we need better regulation to make this stuff happen. How do you see businesses being able to work in a different and more collaborative way with regulators and government than has been the past?
Yeah, clearly this, especially if we talk about packaging waste, it needs regulation and it needs it on multiple fronts. And the reality is the businesses possess more of the operational knowledge, they possess more of the IP knowledge on innovation, and they can help shape what's going to work. Of course, the regulators need to have some appropriate level of skepticism about whether they're being engaged with fairly or not, but they need to set the playing field. And it happens, and the challenge is across multiple fronts. We need We need regulation to allow the circular economy to function so that recycled materials can come back into primary packaging. There are plenty of countries in the world where we're only just passing laws to allow recycled PET back into food grade packaging. Only the government can put those laws in place. You get regulation on how to the collection systems. The biggest barrier in the developed world to a circular economy are the collection systems. And those are not just complicated national issues. They are often local, whether you're in a state or a county, issues. And the way they're set up matters tremendously.
And how would you advise business leaders to kind of step forward into an environment that requires regulation? Because it is still the case that many businesses are pushing back on regulation all the time, almost regardless of what it is. How do we help businesses change their stance to make this happen well?
It goes back to the beginning. Do we agree on the objective and goal? Do we agree on less waste to the environment and a circular economy because it has a lower carbon footprint, and this is a positive way forward and ultimately can be lower cost for business? If you agree with that as a premise, then everything else can become as consequence. And businesses very typically need to work in collaboration with each other. They need to form alliances. Governments find it much easier to deal with all manufacturers of a certain thing rather than each of them individually.
And Mariana, in the picture that James is painting there, very similar to you, bring the whole system together. Do you feel that business has an opportunity or indeed a regulation, an opportunity or indeed really an obligation to demonstrate to governments that what is possible? Because very often in making shift happen in a real way, in practical terms, regulators sometimes find it difficult to see what is actually possible. Has business got a role in making that come alive in the regulatory world?
Sure, but can I just say, I want to start from a very different premise. You know, the state and the public sector is not there just to be a regulator. Everything that makes our iPhones smart or not stupid actually came from public investment, very risk-taking, internet, GPS, touchscreen, Siri. Same thing with renewable energy, most big innovations around solar, wind, marine, fusion, fracking even came actually from high risk, early stage public investments of different types. So let's just get out of this idea that, sorry if I'm being so bold on this, but this has been what I've been writing about for 20 years. The public sector also invests. And when they do so, they actually should be then governing the system around these technologies in such a way to produce kind of public goods and public value. And we can come back to that later. But I do think that just the narrative that this is just about regulation as opposed to collectively creating value in particular ways. And I definitely agree with James. If then the regulation is wrong, if the environment is not certain for businesses to actually be able to be rewarded for doing the good thing, as opposed to kind of, you know, whether it's problematic tax policy or, you know, regulations that are just kind of badly devised, that's a huge problem. But again, it's not just about regulation.
And I think that one of the things that we wanted to touch on while we were all together is the fact that actually the circular economy doesn't exist yet. We're all trying to make it happen. And so and people are working on corners of it, showing what's possible, pushing it along. So if we look into the future, what should we actually be gripping? What are the really priority areas to focus on to take us to the next stage in this arena? Mariana?
Well, I think if we think of the circular economy not just as something peripheral to the economy that then, you know, the treasuries, the ministries of finance and CEOs can talk about, but at the center of how we direct the economy and how we also build the economic models themselves of how we understand growth processes, then that's where we're going to have change. And unfortunately, so far, I think a lot of the people advocating for the circular economy haven't necessarily gotten their hands dirty enough in terms of the economics of it. And so I think that's a real opportunity. And I do think it has to go to the center of how we value. You know, I totally agree with James. You know, what are we actually trying to do? If that has to be the starting point. But what does that actually then mean for how we construct, you know, GDP indices that are much better than they currently are? But also in terms of valuing what has been done. And you'll know that everything government does, whether it's public education, public health, public transport, or their energy programs get evaluated. Often those evaluation metrics are really static. They're based on kind of cost-benefit analysis, net present value calculations. And I think we do need to ask ourselves, what are the implications of having this kind of mission-oriented approach that I talk about, James's point about actually, you know, focusing on the goals, working together to achieve them, and welcoming all the spillovers that might happen along the way across the entire economy for how we then evaluate how well we're doing. And we have to get out of these static frameworks and linear frameworks and really kind of welcome the serendipity actually that might also happen along the way. But it has to be economy-wide, intersectoral, and interactor.
Fantastic. And James, where would you put the priority focus for the future, the things we've lost grip?
So firstly, the future is already with us. There are places, particularly where we have high value, for example, packaging materials. The circular economy has been brought to life. We have countries where we see 100% collection of packages and we reuse the material back in our own packaging, and we've been able to demonstrate we can make it work. The problem is it's just not widespread enough. So the first point is, for high value items, it does not require a technological breakthrough. It requires a systems and organizational breakthrough. And it's doable because we're doing it collectively with other manufacturers, with retailers, and with government. It's about getting it into more places. The bit where I think is the next biggest challenge is all the low value items. The, you know, plastics itself has high value items that can be recycled and has, you know, equal value to the original material. And there's other stuff that once collected has no recycling value. There's nothing you can do with it, or at least not today. And that's where I agree with Mariana. Profound innovation is required to change the part of the story which is all about low value packaging or any other items we use in the economy. So for high value items, it's an organizational problem and it's a question of will among the actors. And for low value items, listen, sachets and the famous straws and things like that, there it's about innovation, private and public innovation, to come up with new materials or new ways of recycling those existing materials such that they can create a circular economy.
And can I just add, it has to be, I completely agree with James, but coming back to the design issue, any money given by governments to any sector should increasingly have these goals at the center of the transformation, right? So, you know, and it doesn't have to happen right away, but you need to be committing to turning your whole value chain into a circular value chain in order to get a subsidy, a guarantee, a loan, a recovery fund.
Shifting the system requires action from all actors, government, business, and citizens. Jyrki Katainen, the former Prime Minister of Finland and now President of SITRA, has witnessed the circular economy move from just a fringe idea to the mainstream. And he's seen that across both public and private sectors, and nationally and internationally. He spoke with Joss, who leads our work with institutions, governments and cities, about how to shift the system and what happens when the system starts to shift itself.
What is your personal experience of systemic change? Have you seen it at play? And if so, where does it happen? Where does it pick up fast? Where can it really scale?
Funny that you ask, because I must admit that when I still was a Prime Minister of Finland, and if somebody came to me and said that we need a systemic change, I almost immediately shut my ears because it sounded, the term systemic change and I should do a systemic change sound so overwhelming. But then being in the commission and being one of those who was introducing the circular economy as a policy matter in the European level, I must admit that it is the first time when I experienced that systemic change can really happen in relatively short period of time. So I started to believe that all the single pieces of market regulation, for instance, or all the legislative proposals concerning product policy, they are parts of the systemic change. And we saw already that market is changing. And now we see it much better than 5 years ago. So this is the first time to wrap up. This is the first time when I participated really to systemic change, and the first time when I see it happening really here and fast.
When it comes to climate, which has been a big push of the World Circular Economy Forum this year, do you feel that the link between circular economy and climate is being made with more detail, more granularity now?
I try to understand the history of circular economy as we know it today. It's not that long. So circular economy came to the political agenda some 6 years ago, one could say. And now it's grown up enough that a big amount of people understand how important vehicle it is, for instance, when addressing climate change. So this year is the first year when I see really circular economy taking off, for instance, when we talk about climate change. And it's very, very encouraging. So companies, but also policymakers, seems to understand that at the same time when we create global rules how much each of the countries needs to reduce the CO2 emissions, we have to devise ways to enable economic growth to continue. But the quality of it must change significantly. And here, circular economy comes to the picture. You mentioned biodiversity. I believe biodiversity is next climate. So it's going to be as big issue politically and economically and from societal change point of view as the climate change has been during the last few years. So we need market-based solutions to address biodiversity loss. And here again, circular economy can play or will play a crucial role.
And Finland has a really, really big bioeconomy. The biomass and the nature-based economy is really important in the country's GDP. So how are you tackling this nationally? Is it through potentially having better indicators to understand the impact or to make the contribution of bio-sourced materials greater in the economy, for instance? What is the country doing on that level?
Yeah, I think we need both. We need more protected areas. We need new market-based solutions. And we need more bio-based products which replace fossil-based products, etc. But there's a debate going on how big part of the country, including water area, should be protected. If we end up protecting 30% of the overall size of the country, equally important issue is to look at what happens to the rest 70%. So we cannot pretend that just protecting certain amount of the country or the water area is enough. We have to do a systemic change how our economy is functioning, what kind of choices consumers can do, what is the role of municipalities or public sector, for instance, when doing city planning, etc. So this again needs a systemic change, but it's very practical and pragmatic systemic change which is needed. So still we want to get economic growth because it's very important from social perspective, well-being perspective, but the quality of it must change significantly.
Maybe one final question, because we're now on the international stage. There is an important dimension of the circular economy is what does it do to trade and to commercial relationships between countries? And I know that Finland has been thinking about that, was instrumental in putting together a study created by the IEEP a few years ago. So that debate, how do you see it panning out when potentially, you mentioned the United Nations Environmental Assembly, some countries might feel that actually circular economy is not great for them because they sell their natural resources and that's the way they fuel their GDP. So how do we get to alignment and consensus on these notions?
Yeah, it's this is a typical way of thinking. But I guess that also in those countries who are mainly a seller of raw materials, they understand that it's always better if they could process their raw materials in their own country. So this is the first thing. But the second thing is that the market will change. Market will change. And the circular economy will win more space. That is for sure. It's a winning card. So that's why we need better international cooperation. Also, trade policy can be seen as a great enabler for promoting circular economy. So in order to address the climate issue or biodiversity loss, we need economic-related innovations, and circular economy offers lots of opportunities in this front. So this kind of international agreements or decisions which handle, for instance, economic or trade-related issues are never easy. But I'm quite confident that the time is up, so that people see where we all are going to, or what is the direction where we have to go in order to address these challenges.
In addition to action and regulation, incentives and policy, governments are big investors in innovation. At the top of the show, Mariana referenced government-funded breakthrough technologies from the moon landing to the touchscreen.
And the circular economy is a huge innovation opportunity. It requires the discovery and scale-up of new production, distribution, and recycling infrastructure, a new generation of materials, and a wave of new business models. But all of this needs to happen at great speed.
To do this, we need a strategic and ambitious public-private investment. Let's zoom in. Materials innovation could offer profound new opportunities and unlock the shift to a circular economy.
The MIT Technology Review's David Rotman spoke with chemist and professor at Toronto University Alan Aspuru-Guzik and MIT professor and architect Sheila Kennedy about the present, past and future of our materials.
Ready to roll? Take one.
We're going to talk about materials now. It is such an interesting topic to me because materials are at the big core of so much of what we do in our lives, and yet we don't talk enough about how to get better materials, more sustainable materials, materials that can improve climate change. So we have some great topics to discuss, but I want to first ask each of our speakers just to tell me what you do in terms of materials. Alan, I know you're a researcher, you invent, you create, you discover new materials. Just very quickly, how do you think about what you do in terms of the future of materials?
I am very obsessed with how slow we discover materials. Materials are discovered usually in a time cycle of 10 to 15 years from idea to market. So what I do is I look at applications that matter to the world, like energy storage, energy generation, or displays, and try to build materials for those applications in a faster way by means of artificial intelligence and automation. So I combine the chemistry, artificial intelligence, and automation to try to speed up the process of materials discovery with the hope of having these materials in the world faster to solve some of the largest challenges that humanity has right now.
Right. We'll get into some more of that. But Sheila, you're an architect. Tell us how you think about materials.
Right. Well, I've got sort of two big jobs, I think. As an architect, I'm involved in everything that it takes to make ecologically responsible buildings. And really, furniture, objects, products across a range of scales. And then as a professor, I'm really obsessed about connecting research and education and in understanding the culture of materials in the built environment and how we can evolve and transform that.
Sheila, I'm curious, what is an example of a material that we might be familiar with and that we might not be thinking enough about the benefits of?
Well, if we're talking about structures, I could put air out there. I think we're on this planet, I think we're pretty familiar with air, although we may be getting less familiar with it, in that we can think about inflatable structures, very strong beams, the use of so-called soft structures like air, textiles, and deploying those instead of the really reduced palette of materials that we've somehow culturally inherited. When I say we, I mean the sort of discipline of architecture and maybe people in general. We think of a very small set of architectural materials. Concrete, as Alain mentioned, we might think of steel, we might think of glass. So our palette has become very reduced. And as we move from a economy to an ecology of materials, we're going to see that really broaden out, including all the augmented and new materials that Alain's working on.
Right, we really have to think about the whole materials are used in, on a macro scale. It's a whole system and a system approach to materials.
Yeah.
So how do we think about incorporating into this the system, into all these things we're talking about, new materials or old materials with benefits? How do we think about sort of the next generation and making sure that we're thinking about the consequences of this next generation of materials?
Well, I think there are two parts to that question. Maybe talking about the first part first. What's the paradigm shift? What's changing? I think that materials were understood as kind of singular things. You didn't think much about them. If you're an architect, you just specify them. In other words, you order them and they come to you, somewhat like Amazon, actually, you know, but big, vast masses of material coming to a building site. And then once they were in a building, you didn't think much about them. You didn't think much about their end of life. Somehow, you know, they when the building, was taken down or whatever, they went into a landfill. So that's extremely linear. And I think that we are seeing a shift from a linear, singular notion of one material at a time that we understand and use to a much more plural ecology of materials where we're really thinking about what has been called an externality. In other words, we're thinking about the energy that goes into extracting that material, into processing it, into augmenting it, into getting it to the building, transportation, labor, and then how, at the end of life, it returns back into that larger ecology, returns back safely and in a way that it can be upcycled or reused.
So Alan, when you're thinking about creating, inventing new materials, you know, you must think about the long-term consequences of those materials, how they could be used, what would be their impact. But take us back when you first start thinking about, oh, this might be an interesting material. How do you think about sort of the longer-term consequences of those materials?
Well, this is interesting, right? It depends on the class of material. For example, if in my work in display molecules or in organic laser molecules, the amount of organic molecule that's going to be in a cell phone display or a computer display is tiny. You know, literally the world production of these display materials is a few tons. So compared to, you know, building materials, really we're talking about extremely sophisticated things that you can think about them as the most expensive inks, so to speak, in the world, right? On the other hand, we also are thinking of super large scale, right? Like what kind of molecule could store the entirety of the world's energy in scale? I mean, it will be a fraction of it, but the same order of magnitude. And when you the reason we're thinking about this problem is you think about, going 100% to renewables, you need to have batteries. And in those batteries, you probably don't want to use transition metals that were extracted from mines with terrible conditions, but rather, why not think of organic molecules? And for example, in that particular case, together with Roy Gordon and Mike Aziz, early on, about 5 years ago, we thought about what molecules does our body use to store energy. And turns out there's this biomolecule called quinone that we plants and our body uses all the time to transport electrons. And we said, if it transports electrons in our body, why don't we just mass scale and imagine a world where we can mass scale and produce a quinone molecule to store all the world's energy. But then the question was, which quinone or quinone-like molecule? Now we're working in other molecular classes that are similar to it. And that led us to search literally about a million molecules in the computer so far. And many of them have been tested experimentally, both at Harvard and now in Toronto, where I am, to fulfill this role, right? They have to be long-lived, but they also have to be non-toxic. Ideally, we want to drink our battery. That's our joke, but it's kind of true. What we really want to do is drink our own batteries.
Let's talk about time scale. This is an interesting topic always to me. You know, when can this happen? How fast can it happen? We're talking about huge changes to the economy, to industry, to how we build and construct things.
Well, I think Alan's trying to make it faster. That's for sure.
Alan, you're trying to make it faster. We know the target of decarbonizing, improving biodiversity. So each of you, time scale. How do you think about time scale? How do you try to speed it up? Mm-hmm. Alan, maybe you want to take this one first.
Sure. So let's talk about light emitting diodes. We're discovered in the 80s, commercialized in the early 2000s. That's the 20-year time period that I'm talking about. So in my laboratory, we are now working on organic lasers. Okay. So the next technology will be a coherent emitter that does the same thing. And for that, we built a huge robotic system that synthesizes, characterizes them, and tests them in the same place. We call those systems materials acceleration platforms or self-driving laboratories, a little bit more colloquial, but more accurate, because AI is driving the laboratory to make its decisions in the most optimal way. Those laboratories, in principle, should be able, and this is our thesis, to lower this by an order of magnitude to take us to 1 or 2 years between ideation and production of a candidate material. If we're integrated with people like Sheila, that know the application context and can actually, for example, give us lower requirements or better applications or creative ideas, right? Then these materials could eventually start making an impact sooner. So we need all the chain from the basic scientist to the applied scientist to the engineer to the factories to the users, which could be the architects or other different sectors of society talking to each other. And this is what we like to call a platform. Last thing I will say to invite a lot of the viewers is that we are trying to make Toronto the Mecca, the capital, the world's place to look to for this. So I will invite everybody to look at acceleration consortium.ai. In that consortium, we're bringing government, industry, and academia, and industry is extremely important here, to build the pre-competitive technologies that will be needed to do this.
Yeah, you know, I think that we tend to think that the materials of the future or that we're going to need in the near future are going to need to be very durable. And I think that some do. You know, for example, I'm thinking about understanding a building as a kind of carbon bank, something that can amortize all of its embodied energy and that maybe can change, like, change its cladding and so forth over time. But at the same time, in terms of timescales, I think we can also see very ephemeral materials that we actually maybe just use once or twice and throw them away. Why is that not a problem? Because those materials could actually merge into a compost pit. Those materials could really be designed for a very short term. So I think it is essential to understand the functionality of the materials and not get caught up in searching for the perfect material when there's a really important application that can happen that's just in front of our noses.
Interesting. It does strike me in terms of thinking about time scale, you have a whole spectrum from the discovery of materials, which Alan is really a leader in the world in doing, speeding that up, to testing them.
I think it's really important as an educator that we continue to try to connect education and learning with material experimentation.
And living materials.
Living materials. I think Alan would agree with this too, that we're moving from industrial, mechanical applications for materials to biological and living applications for materials. And while molecules have these amazing properties, so too around us, things like agriculture, plants, trees are absolutely amazing forms of technology that are biological, right? If you think about a plant, it produces its own renewable energy. It stores that chemically. It's pretty resilient. It finds its own water. It's a pretty amazing thing. So at MIT, there is a new field that Michael Strano and I are developing called plant nanobionics. And there we are actually looking to augment the chemistry and energy of plants to give living plants and living materials new capacities. For example, the ability to make ambient light. And that light is ambient, it's relatively dim, but it's gotten a lot brighter, and I'm pretty confident that the time frame for that is going to be decreasing. So imagine growing your own light, right? Imagine getting rid of the electrical grid altogether and being able to take a small plant and bring it close to the page that you're looking at and be able to enhance literacy. So we can ensure that we're working with materials that are safe because we could start with materials that are safe. We don't need to modify plants. They're already doing these amazing things.
That's great. I think this is just a start of a conversation. And I think, as you put it, imagining the future of materials and imagining a future of materials that leads to a much more sustainable environment, a much more sustainable economy, and really brings many benefits that we're hoping for.
Alan, Sheila, and David talked about the shift from a materials economy to a materials ecology. And they are not the only ones who think this way. Alicia Garmalevich from the Universidad de Santiago de Chile is involved in a global movement to transform how and where we produce and use materials, enabling a system shift to a circular economy.
In some ways, materials are kind of an unthought about part of our economy in a weird way. Like, obviously, I'm interacting with a whole host of materials right now, and all of us are in our daily lives. Is some of the impetus behind Materium that fact that actually the world of materials is slightly unexplored?
I think that's true, and it's something that we've lost touch with in terms of being really having a deep knowledge and understanding about the material world that we inhabit and consume in every day. And that's a large impetus and motivation behind Materium is to open up access to that knowledge, and specifically through the lens of biomaterials, bioplastics, biocomposites. These are actually with chemistry methods that are very accessible. We use life-friendly chemistry methods. This actually enables people to participate in ways that previously is really out of the realm of possibility for people. So unless you're a polymer chemist or a material scientist, you never really get in touch with material development, where we're trying to open that up to more people in more places. And we think that will actually drive innovation as well, commercial innovation.
And there's a focus on biomaterials. What is it that's exciting about the idea of biomaterials? I guess you tapped into it a little bit just now, but why the focus on biomaterials?
Yes, well, the potential of biomaterials is massive when you look actually at just the volume of biopolymers that are in flow in the global biosphere that compose and make up the incredible material production that the natural world is made out of. And so, for instance, you can look at the biopolymer chitin, which is composes the exoskeletons of insects, the crustacean shells, as well as the cell walls of fungi. It's an incredible biopolymer that's so abundant. It's about 100 billion tons in flow in the biosphere annually. And that's actually the amount of chitin produced in 1 year is equivalent to greater than 300 years of the current worldwide plastics production. So it just shows the kind of scale of materials that we could actually be building with and developing. And that's not even mentioning cellulose. So cellulose is 2 teratons per year, which is orders of magnitude higher. And so that why I mention that is that you have to put our production of petrochemical plastics in context. And that is minuscule. We're producing about over 300 million tons per year of petrochemical plastics, which is incredibly problematic when they bioaccumulate and are in our drinking water and causing problems for other organisms. But it shows that it's not necessarily the material world that we're part of. It's what that's composed of, what the actual building blocks we're using. And so substituting those building blocks, I think, will have an enormous potential for us to have build habitat products, etc., that are fundamentally regenerative. So this is not to say that biomaterials need to compose everything in our economy, but where the real opportunity lies is in fast-moving consumer goods, where you've got high volume and it's the throughput is really fast. And you need to therefore grapple with the fact that there's going to be leakage. It's incredibly difficult to design that out. And so that's where it's really important to look at using bio-based building blocks that are effective after end of life, no matter where they go. So you can have small amounts of leakage, depending on the quantity and volume, that are regenerative and not necessarily detrimental. And that's where I think the biomaterial economy is specifically suited to that sector.
I really like it when you give that fact about chitin, Alicia, because I quote that quite often. So whenever I hear you say it, I'm getting it right. And I think what it illustrates really powerfully is this notion that very often our response to the challenges we see is to do less, is to have less. And that example and the point about being inspired by natural systems emphasises the fact that we can have abundance if the building blocks are right, if the principles are right, if the design is right. And I guess like we're getting into it already, but it's worthwhile making maybe the connection a bit more explicit. In your view, how does this kind of materials innovation space contribute to a circular economy?
So the importance of regenerative materials for the circular economy is really, it's the starting point for everything when you think about product life cycles. And so if you get materials right in terms of making sure that the building blocks and that the way they're composed and fit together, make sure that they can go back into natural systems as productive nutrients after end of life, that means that that entire product can be thought of as regenerative. Now, there's lots of steps along the way, but it's really, really important to get that foundation right. So I see Materium and what we're doing and providing that layer of information as providing that kind of that paint box, that palette for what you want to compose for products in circulation everywhere. And as soon as we get the materials right and the chemistry right, we're well along the way to make sure that any product we make goes back into a cycle in a way that's not just zero impact, but actually has a positive impact on any source ecosystem that's actually supporting our productive economy.
How do we scale these innovations? People might be watching and saying, well, I'm really excited, but what does it look like to take this world of materials innovation, biomaterials to scale?
It really requires changing our lens on what scale means. So in today's world, we're very familiar with the concept of scale being associated with centralized mass manufacturing. So we produce a lot of things in one location and then export it globally. And that's something that doesn't work with a biomaterial economy and biomaterial supply chains, because A, there's a lot of secondary and third generation biomass that is highly distributed. So think of food waste, for instance, or agricultural byproducts. That's something that's very difficult to centralize and produce from. And you actually risk over extracting any given source ecosystem if you try and scale up in any one location in a traditional mass manufacturing sense. The thing that we need to think about is scaling horizontally. So actually, we want to scale by propagating these solutions at local and regional scales. So if you imagine, again, being nature inspired, we're talking about cycling nutrients, cycling materials at local and regional scales, where the intelligence, the knowledge, the understanding of what's available, and therefore the rate of nutrient return that's necessary to keep the system regenerative, that's built in to the system. And so we see Materium and the kind of the sea change we want to inspire as being the information layer that allows people everywhere at small and medium scales to be able to adopt new materials, commercialize them, and enter into the market. Now, that's not to say that large companies are somehow not part of that potential vision. It's just that we have to rethink the way supply chains operate. So you may have global brands, but the way in which they're sourcing nutrients may actually be more regionalized. And the great thing about working with the palette of building blocks that we talk about, so the biopolymers like chitin and cellulose and starch and seaweed biopolymers, for instance, all of these amazing building blocks, they actually are repeated across biomes everywhere. And so even though you may be sourcing from slightly different sources of biomass, depending on location, the building blocks themselves are quite sourceable everywhere. And so it's something where we can share knowledge across biomes, and we can share knowledge across these kind of these more regionalized supply chains. So the knowledge is digital, but the materials cycle at local and regional levels.
And what's really interesting about that story is, in many ways, what could be viewed as a material story is really a system story. Like, the material innovation is a lens into redesigning the system. They're the building blocks of the system. But, you know, you're beginning to talk about, well, the supply chains, the scale, how it works, toggling between that global and local view. Alicia Gomilevich, thank you so much for joining us and making the time to chat.
Alicia, offering there an exciting glimpse of the future. Okay, we're nearly there, Joe. The summit is just one part of a series of conversations that the Foundation hosts on these themes. Here is a taste of some of our recent content from our Circular Economy show.
China is planning to build something between 20,000 and 50,000 new high-rise buildings. That is up to 10 New York cities by 2025. So we think about the scales. So China is still continued, you know, having this rapid urbanization, and all of this present massive opportunities for cities in China to apply the circular economy principles.
Latin America has always, since the colonization times, depend on extracting and exporting its resources, having added very, very little value to it. And hence intelligence and skills, jobs, etc. are limited and not even compared to the wealth of resources that we have. So I think circular economy can close that gap and deliver better growth.
But I think what people are beginning to realize is that it's a billion-dollar informal sector that is not really being taken seriously or being approached in a meaningful way. And so I think people need to change the attitude towards what electronic waste is and sort of the opportunities that lie. Because I don't think that, I think to simply discard it as waste is, there's an irony imbued then, because it's just sort of like undiscovered resources that just need to be channeled towards the right value chains.
However, in China, circular economy is widely adopted to solve the environment pollution associated with industries, to reconcile the economic growth and the environment and the social concerns.
But I think what really adds value to the Latin American and Caribbean continent is about creating and adding value, regenerative value to its abundant natural resources. It is about the very important and core aspect of a circular economy, which is to create a resilient and distributed and diverse and inclusive economy that will create prosperity to all in the long term.
From China to Ghana to Brazil, the ideas of transforming the economy to fix the climate, better growth, and shifting the system have global resonance. Our Circular Economy Show takes place every 2 weeks on YouTube, LinkedIn, and Facebook. So make sure to follow us and tune into those regular broadcasts.
So that's a wrap. The circular economy can address the root causes of our most pressing global challenges. Hopefully, we have managed to demonstrate that business leaders, policymakers, designers, researchers, and entrepreneurs are taking action, and they are doing so globally.
It is a journey, and we are in the early days, but we are seeing progress. Now, we need to go bigger, and we need to do it faster.
Thank you for joining us, and tune in to the Circular Economy Show to stay connected to our latest insights and developments. We'll see you there. Bye.
Bye.